Learning medicine is hard work. Osmosis makes it easy. It takes your lectures and notes to create a personalized study plan with exclusive videos, practice questions, and flashcards, and so much more. Try it free today.
Neuroblastoma is a type of tumor composed of neuroblasts, specifically neural crest cells, which are cells involved in the development of the sympathetic nervous system. Neuroblastoma is the most common cancer in infants, and it's only rarely seen in children over 5 years old. When a fetus is in its fifth week of development, special cells called neural crest cells start migrating along the spine. In the thoracic region of the spine, neural crest cells differentiate into the neurons of the sympathetic chain, lying on either side of the entire spinal cord. In the lumbar region, neural crest cells differentiate into the cells of the adrenal medulla, the inner part of the adrenal gland that sits atop the kidneys. Together, the sympathetic chain and adrenal medulla form the sympathetic nervous system, connecting the brain and central nervous system to various organs, including the heart and blood vessels. So, when you're under some sort of stress, maybe playing a super competitive sport, like badminton, the sympathetic nervous system kicks into action. The sympathetic neurons release norepinephrine, also called noradrenaline, and the cells of the adrenal medulla release norepinephrine and epinephrine, also called adrenaline. These hormones bind to receptors in various tissues, like the blood vessels, the heart, and the lungs, redirecting blood flow to your muscles, making your heart pump faster, and expanding the airways in your lungs, all of which can help you make that winning hit. After the game is over and the hormones are no longer needed, epinephrine and norepinephrine break down into metabolites like homovanillic acid, or HMA, and vanillomandelic acid, or VMA. In neuroblastoma, some neural crest cells in the sympathetic chain or the adrenal medulla don't differentiate properly during fetal development, and these cells ultimately go on to form a tumor, which most often forms in the adrenal medulla but can also develop in other areas of the sympathetic chain. While no one knows exactly how it happens, this abnormal cell differentiation has been associated with mutations in the MYCN oncogene, anaplastic lymphoma kinase ALK fusion oncogenes, and mutations in tumor suppressor genes, like the paired-like homeobox 2B, or FOX2B, and other tumor suppressor genes on chromosome 1 and 11. Oncogenes help cells grow and proliferate, while tumor suppressor genes slow down cell growth and proliferation. So, both an MYCN amplification, or ALK gene fusion, where the oncogene is turned on, or a FOX2B and chromosome 1 and 11 deletions, where tumor suppressor genes are turned off, can potentially cause uncontrolled cell growth. There are three types of neuroblastomas, and they're categorized based on the size and shape of the tumor cells: undifferentiated, poorly differentiated, and differentiating neuroblastoma. An undifferentiated neuroblastoma is mostly comprised of neural crest cells, which are sometimes called small round blue cells, due to a lack of cytoplasm and a large blue nuclei. A poorly differentiated neuroblastoma is composed of slightly more differentiated cells, with smaller nuclei and a bit more cytoplasm. In addition, the cells of a poorly differentiated neuroblastoma may be surrounded by a substance called neuropil, which is a dense network of interwoven nerve fibers like axon and dendrite branches. Finally, a differentiating neuroblastoma is composed of cells with lots of cytoplasm and is often surrounded by a substance called Schwannian stroma. Schwannian stroma is a connective tissue from non-neuronal cells that forms myelin, which insulates the axons of the mature neurons. When any type of neuroblastoma forms, cells in the surrounding tissue release chemokines called CXCL12, and that stimulates nearby immune cells. CXCL12 is normally produced by some organs like the lymph nodes, liver, bones, and especially the bone marrow, but gets produced in higher amounts when the tissue is damaged. When immune cells sense high levels of CXCL12, they get stimulated and move towards the area where it's coming from. As it turns out, neuroblastic tumor cells also get stimulated by CXCL12. If a neuroblastoma cell breaks away and gets into the blood or lymph, it will sometimes migrate towards the organ where CXCL12 is normally produced, creating metastatic tumors there. Symptoms of neuroblastoma result from the chemokine release and include fever, weight loss, sweating, and fatigue. Other symptoms of neuroblastoma depend on where the tumor is located and are usually a result of the tumor pressing up against surrounding organs. For example, if the tumor is in the thoracic region of the sympathetic chain, it can grow into the lungs, causing breathing difficulties. A thoracic tumor that extends to the neck can press up against nerves originating there, and heading toward the face, it can cause Horner syndrome. Horner syndrome involves meiosis, or constriction of the pupils, ptosis, or the drooping of the eyelid, and anhidrosis, which is an inability to sweat in the face. Tumors on the sympathetic chain might also grow into the spine, causing neurologic symptoms, like muscle weakness or bowel and bladder problems. Children with a tumor in the adrenal medulla can have a large, painful abdominal mass that causes abdominal swelling. About half of all blastomas spread to the bones, causing bone pain and small fractures. Classically, neuroblastomas can cause fractures at the base of the skull, just where the skull connects to the spine. With these fractures, fluid and blood can leak into the tissues around the eyes. When that happens, it can cause periorbital ecchymosis, also called raccoon eyes, because of the dark rings of blood that can be seen in the soft tissue around the eyes. Neuroblastoma that invades the bone marrow can also affect the marrow's ability to make healthy red blood cells, platelets, and white blood cells, leading to fatigue, easy bruising, and frequent infections. Diagnosis of neuroblastoma usually starts with testing for HMA and VMA in the blood or urine, since high levels of those metabolites may indicate tumors that secrete epinephrine and norepinephrine. A CT scan can show location and size of the tumor, and a complete blood count can help determine whether neuroblastoma has spread to the bone marrow. Treatment largely depends on the size and staging of the neuroblastoma, meaning how far the tumor has spread. Early on, surgery can be used to remove the tumor, but once it started to spread, it might require a combination of chemotherapy, medication, and even stem cell or bone marrow transplantation. Generally speaking, the best treatment outcomes are among the youngest patients that have a differentiating neuroblastoma. Alright, as a quick recap, neuroblastoma is a condition where neural crest cells of the developing sympathetic nervous system and adrenal medulla do not differentiate normally. Rather, they continue to proliferate in an immature state, creating tumors that press on nearby organs or spread to other organs causing complications, like Horner syndrome and raccoon eyes. High levels of HMA and VMA are usually the first indication of a neuroblastoma.
Thanks for watching. If you're interested in a deeper dive on this topic, take a look at osmosis.org, where we have flashcards, questions, and other awesome tools to help you learn medicine.